Now, these facts are really well put together in this book, The Roots of Obama's Rage by Dinesh D'Souza. Everybody should read this book. It's now the number one selling book on Amazon.com. And I think it's going to be that way for quite some time, because you must read it and pass it on. But here's what we learned last night before we come to our own opinions and conclusions. First, Barack Obama's dad said this: theoretically, there is nothing that can stop the government from taxing 100% of income, so long as the people get benefits from the government. You got it? So in other words, they can take 100% if they want to, as long as it's shared with everybody else. Now, this was his father. His father was a Marxist, an anti-colonial Marxist, not the kind of Marxist that you found in the Soviet Union. Now, his mother, she was also an anti-colonialist. She is Stanley Ann. She married Lolo Cerreto. He was a capitalist, but she didn't really know that. That's why he was sent away. He was sent away to Hawaii, to her grandparents, right here. This is Stanley Ann Dunham's mom and dad. Grandpa decided that he needed to have a role model, somebody that he could really fashion his life after. A mentor, Frank Marshall Davis. This is Frank Marshall Davis's FBI file. It's pretty intense. So this is the dad's writing. Mom sends Barack away because he's being influenced by somebody who's not a Marxist or an anti-colonialist. Sends him to Grandma and Grandpa, who send him right to Frank Marshall Davis, who is a communist with an FBI file. Now, this is the only reason why we're telling you this is because this is who helped shape the young man's worldview, a communist who had a ton of influence. And there's more influence than just his father, but it's, remember, the book is not Dreams of My Father, it is Dreams from My Father. The dreams that Barack Obama got from his father. Now, we go to his mentors. Here are the mentors. Mentors are Edward Said. He's the guy at Columbia. He is a spokesman for the Palestinian National Council. So he is an anti-colonialist. The colonial occupiers, if you will, are Israel. Another one, of course, is Roberto Unger. This guy is also the leading anti-colonial legal scholar. Then, of course, we have Reverend Wright, who the book that Obama wrote, The Audacity of Hope, comes from a sermon that this guy gave. Now, if you've heard any of his sermons, they all include liberation theology, the idea of the oppressed and the oppressor. That's it. Now, the oppressed can be anywhere. They could be here, they could be Africa, they could be Israel, but the oppressors are usually Europe and the United States. Then, of course, Bill Ayers sat with Barack Obama on the board of the Woods Foundation. Anti-colonialism. Remember when we went over the Weather Underground and their manifesto? It was anti-colonialism. That's what they all have in common. From here to here. Anti-colonialism. The idea that there are colonizers and the colonized. There is America or Europe, and then the third world victims, oppressor and victims. All of these things are a fact. Now, you can decide they mean nothing, but they're all facts. We'll get to opinion here in a second. The other thing is, remember, his church is also anti-colonialism. It's liberation theology. There is an oppressor and the oppressed. Remember, I've been talking to you about collective salvation. And the president has said time and time again, my salvation is dependent on a collective salvation. In other words, he must stop the oppressor and help the oppressed. And the only way the oppressor can be stopped, the only way the oppressor can find salvation, is basically you have to give back what you've stolen. Same up here. The colonizers are stealing things from the third world victims. Now, let me just show you one clip first for the theology. This is from the founder of Black Liberation Theology, James Cone. Here it is.
The only way in which your repentance, your forgiveness can be authentic, your reception of it can be authentic, your repentance can be authentic, is that you give back what you took. And white people took a lot from black people.
See, this is where I went wrong and so many Americans went wrong. I went wrong because I thought it was about race for a long time. It's not. It's not. It's not really even about religion. It's not about black and white. It's not about religion. It's not about money. Not about anything. Look, you can be a successful African-American running a bank and you're still the oppressor. Most times it's not called anti-colonialism. How do I know? Well, it's called anti-colonialism or neo-colonialism with these people and in the past, but now it's just fact. I want to show you how I know and how your children know this theory and you don't. I want to show you something that we showed you maybe about a year and a half ago from the Tides Foundation, funded by George Soros, and it is playing at about 4,000 schools all across the country. It is called The Story of Stuff. Here is the way they are teaching your children about anti-colonialism.
If everybody consumed at U.S. rates, we would need 3 to 5 planets.
Here we go.
You know what? We've only got one.
Here it comes.
So my country's response to this limitation is simply to go take somebody else's. This is the third world, which some would say is another word for our stuff that somehow got on somebody else's land. So what does that look like? The same thing. Trashing the place.
Okay. She's saying to kids in school, what is that? That's just us saying our stuff somehow or another got on their land. We are taking, we are stealing from the third world because we're the oppressor. That explains it. You can call it whatever you want, but these are the facts.